William Byrd was one of the blockbuster composers of the English Renaissance and managed a remarkably successful career in turbulent times. As a Catholic in newly Protestant England, where professing the wrong religious belief could lead to torture and execution, Byrd moved with the influential high flyers on both sides. His sheer output, 470 compositions survive, and his long career shows his political skill at courting favor where he needed it. His early life remains a mystery. We can reliably date his birth to 1539 or 1540 from a later legal document, but not much else is known. He seems to have come from a musical family, and he may have been trained by the illustrious Thomas Tallis, another Renaissance musical titan. Whatever his training, he was deemed skillful enough to be given the professional position of organist and master of the choristers at Lincoln Cathedral in 1563. While in Lincoln, his duties included teaching the boys service music, theory, and organ, and recruiting new talent, as well as providing organ accompaniment and composing songs for daily use in church. It is notable that he got in trouble with a local archbishop for playing music that was too elaborate for the new Protestant tastes. The opening Magnificat is from Byrd's setting of the Great Service, which is one of the most elaborate pieces of English service music ever composed. It's the only piece Byrd wrote for 10 voices, his largest scale work. It's from late in his career and was intended for the Chapel Royal, not a provincial cathedral like Lincoln. It would have been performed on major feast days or state occasions at court. While the Nunc Dimittis is often paired with the Magnificat, this setting is a standalone work, liturgically appropriate for the Feast of the Purification of the Blessed Virgin Mary, which is surely what Byrd intended it for. It comes from the Gradualia, his collection of music written for the liturgical year of Catholic feast days, and circulated not so much at court as among his patrons in the remaining Catholic nobility for private use.
Thank you. Oh.
We know Byrd stayed at Lincoln until 1572, when he was appointed a gentleman of the Chapel Royal. He moved to London and began working with his mentor, Thomas Tallis. The roster was a formidable group of talented musicians, and the appointment was well paid and for life. It was also somewhat removed from Protestant reforms. Queen Elizabeth had a sophisticated artistic taste and loved good music. By all accounts, her preferences for beauty won out over orthodoxy, and the services in her chapel had more in common with pre-Reformation high church than the rest of the cathedrals in England at the time. The years after, his move to the Chapel Royal are when his staunch Catholicism begins to build. As he worked among Elizabeth and the Protestants at court, he was cultivating relationships with wealthy and powerful Catholic families who had been forced to move their religious faith underground. Byrd's refusal to conform is apparent in contemporary legal documents. His name appears over and over on recusancy lists, and he was required to pay heavy fines for these repeated offenses. Catholic sympathies are also apparent in many published works, which are full of themes of longing, isolation, and exile. Quomodo cantabimus and Ne irascaris are considered some of the most concrete musical expressions of Byrd's repressed Catholicism. Quomodo is the setting of part of a psalm about living in captivity. It laments, "How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land?" The work's origin is an extraordinary story. It was part of a motet exchange. In 1584, the Flemish composer Philippe de Monte sent Byrd his setting of Super Flumina Babylonis, the first part of Psalm 137. Byrd answered by setting the next four verses of the same psalm in the same key and for the same number of voices. It's both an interesting example of contemporary cultural exchange and also a composition full of somber beauty and longing. Ne irascaris Domine is one of Byrd's most enduringly popular works. It appears in the first volume of his Cantiones Sacrae, published in 1589. The two Cantiones volumes were dedicated to prominent Elizabethan Protestants and may have been Byrd's attempt to get back in the good graces of the court after a period of intense suspicion in the early 1580s. Byrd was associated with a plot to depose Elizabeth and was put on leave from the Chapel Royal and placed under house arrest. Yet he still cannot resist including another veiled reference to the plight of oppressed Catholics. The translation reads, "Zion is a wilderness, Jerusalem a desolation." Even for a piece with a largely major soundscape, the brooding, longing tone is unmistakable. Despite all this, it is Byrd's most popular and widely distributed motet. In one edition, it appears inscribed with the comment, "Good song," next to it.
Thank you.
some of his later collections were never intended for use at the Chapel Royal. In 1594, Byrd semi-retired and moved close to the greatest of his Catholic patrons in Essex. They held secret and intimate Catholic services at their estate, far away from the center of political and religious authority at court. Byrd's later works circulated through this community to provide music for just such occasions. Ave Verum Corpus is a composition from the Gradualia, one of these later collections. The words are traditionally associated with the Feast of Corpus Christi, which was still enthusiastically observed by Catholic recusants at the time. Traditionally, celebrations included an outdoor procession around a church after an elevated host. Driven underground, Catholics continued to process around their houses and gardens to observe the tradition. Our final piece, Ad Dominum cum tribularer, like the Great Service, is another uncharacteristically large-scale work from Byrd, who normally wrote on a more intimate scale. It was never included in any of his published collections, and may have been more of a technical exercise than anything else. The texture is dense, and there are few moments of relief from the unrelenting layers of polyphony. The music conveys an intensity like no other motet, set to images of war, like sharp arrows of the mighty with searing coals. This monumental motet feels more like a 10-minute battle cry that ends with a big finish and an epic sense of relief. Though Byrd spent his last years mostly away from court, and despite his enduring unwillingness to be a good practicing Protestant, he never lost full favor with the ruling establishment. His death in 1623 is recorded in the account books of the Chapel Royal, and beside his name is the fond phrase, "A father of music." Thank you so much for joining our broadcast this evening. If you want to hear more about our work, upcoming concerts, virtual and otherwise, hope you'll visit our website at birdensemble.com. If you want to support the broadcast, you're welcome to make a donation or purchase a virtual ticket on our website. Thank you.